Not a good thing.
That was the end of that part of the tradition.
Yes. Let's move on to something else.
Yeah.
So whenever I see your name on anything, I always think that you're going to run into a 23-year-old.
Yeah, not anymore, I'm afraid.
But you've been doing this for a long time.
I know. It's a crazy thing that happens where you start out and you're younger than everybody and you're surprisingly young. That's what I always say is I'm no longer surprisingly young to be doing this. On my first movie, I was like the youngest person on the whole crew. Zero Effect in Portland, and that was in 1997. And now, I'm not the youngest person on the crew anymore by a long shot.
So there's all this heat around Zero Effect, though it didn't do a huge amount of business, but it was kind of the it movie of that moment.
Really?
Well, that's what I felt from the outside, I guess.
If so, I was not aware that that was the case.
Well, it was kind of like this beloved, quirky, different, you know, it was like breaking expectations.
And that's good.
Maintaining some, but you didn't feel that at all from your side of it after it was happening?
You know, the sensation from my side of it was that I loved making it. It was a, you know, definitive experience. And we all had a really good time, and I was really excited about it. And then the sensation from my point of view was that it came out, and it was like no one even noticed that it had come out. You know what I mean? It came and went really fast. It was right. Came out in January, which is always really hard.
It's a bad sign,
right, yes. In the middle of the Titanic's like ascendance to what Titanic became, and it was just like one of 50 movies that came out that was sort of, you know, like unfortunate to live in the era of Titanic, and then. And you know that, and it was a bummer. And then the truth of it is, that was like right before DVD became what it has become, and since started to almost stop being. But you know, the thing where movies had now have all of these afterlives, and it's not just a matter of like rent the video, or you know, hope you catch it on cable. It was like it. People really see a lot of their movies that way now, and expect to and plan to, and it's not like it's not a rejection when they see movies that way, you know. But at the time, that was just sort of starting, so it was like a great surprise when in the following years people kind of caught up to it, you know.
So was that something that you had to get used to? I mean, are you? You're kind of right on the cusp of the generational shift, really.
Yeah.
But I mean, I really want everybody to see this on a big screen, that's a priority, or do you have mixed feelings about it?
Well, when it comes out, you really want them to, you know?
Right.
And you spend a lot of time and work trying to make it great for that presentation, you know? But, you know, I've had the experience a few times where that's how people catch up with it.
Right.
And you're incredibly grateful that they do, you know.
So do the experiences along the way, you've done five films and you've done a lot of television in the middle, but you've done five films in 13 years now, I guess, you've been shooting these things?
I guess so, when you put it that way, yeah.
Does that seem like a lot to you or a little to you?
Five movies?
Yeah. I mean, it's not quite Kubrickian, but it's a limited output for somebody who does.
Yeah, I guess so. It's hard to keep it going. So on some level, you know, there. And when you write them, I didn't write Bad Teacher, but I wrote a bunch of my movies. You know, and that takes a while. And then once you write it, it's not always easy to get them going. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so I've been through periods where it had been a few years, and then in the last... 5 years or so, I've made three, and or I guess 6 years, I've made three movies, and that's, you know, it's hard to keep up that clip, though.
So do you see yourself as writer first, director second, or?
You know, I always do sort of see myself as a writer first, but the truth is I've done more directing now than produced writing, you know, and so I increasingly I see myself as a director as well, and it's, you know, that is the more fun part of it for me a little bit, and so I, you know, grateful for it.
So how did this script come into your life?
This script came to me just it was you know, people were aware of this incredibly funny piece of writing, and a few people told me about it, and I read it and thought it was one of the funniest things I'd ever read, and I wanted to make it, and it was really pretty much that simple, you know.
So as you said, I want to make it, and they just said, "Come on down, you make it."
No, that wasn't quite as simple. My impulse was pretty simple. But I was fortunate that it, you know, I went in and told them what I thought it was and should be and how excited I was about it. And it was the people at Columbia I had made the last movie for as well, Walk Hard, and they're great, great people to work for. And I was fortunate that I was able to persuade them that I should do this one, you know.
So when you came on, did you have, was anybody attached to it, or was it just the script at that
No,
point?
it's just a script.
So how'd you go about putting that together? Because the cast is kind of remarkable from top to bottom in this one.
Well, yeah, it's a great group, and we, you know, this is the kind of movie. I mean, on some level, I think a lot of movies are like this, but this particular kind of comedy, it's really like there's what the writing is,
Right.
and then there's who's playing the parts, and that's like 90% of the movie, you know, and it's that's kind of the that's all that's in this movie is the words and the people saying them, sort of, you know, and
So how do you approach that as a director? I mean, you've been a
well, I
writer
mean, you
director,
start
you've
with
had your
the
hands.
center and work your way out, kind of, you know. In this case, the very clear first move was to try and get Cameron to play this part, you
But I
know.
mean, are you at that point just the ringmaster? Are you trying to make all the pieces work right? You approach it the same way you would approach something that you had written, for instance, as a director?
Yeah,
Okay.
I think that's right. It's a good way of putting it. You're trying to make all the pieces work right, you know? But a huge part of the directing really is the movie like this, who you put in it, you
Right.
know?
So Cameron was the obvious choice because
Yeah.
she's so obviously not in need of a breast job or.
She's a sense of humor. You know, she's one of the only actresses, really. She might be the only actress whose relationship to the comedy audience is that she's completely outrageous and unafraid to be sort of edgy and dirty in comedies. And you know, she's obviously beautiful in a way that was right for the character. And it was just the obvious first place to go.
It's interesting that she is really the only actress
Yeah.
out there in the comedy world that actually has international value as well. She actually does business
Man,
worldwide. She's
yeah, she's done you know, she's had a lot of movies that have played all over the world,
Yeah, she's made some bad movies that have played well overseas. So you can imagine if
you
she's in a good movie,
know.
it might actually be great.
Well, I think, you know, she's a pretty much a universal appeal.
Yeah. So is there an intro? Is there a hangover connectiveness to this? I mean, is there a sense that the studio wants to make a movie like this because they've seen it work with a hangover and therefore it's safer? Or do you think it's something that might have gotten made anyway?
Well, I mean, you know, Hangover was obviously historic kind
Yeah.
of success that for sure. I mean, we were talking about making this movie before that movie came out, but nonetheless, you know, I mean, I think that you know, there's been a wave of R-rated comedies in the last 6 years or so, of which Hangover is one of them and the most kind of astronomically successful. But there's also, you know, all of Judd's
Right.
movies, and I mean, starting with, you know, Anchorman and Virgin, and this sort of wave
Wow.
of R-rated comedies that have been really popular and opened up the possibility of making more R-rated
So
comedies,
you
you
guys cut
know.
yours down to a PG-13, didn't you?
Which
On
one?
Dewey?
No,
Walk
no.
Hard was
No,
R-10?
Walk
Okay.
Hard is a hard R
A hard R.
with the penis.
Lot of penis.
Prominent penis, that gets you right there,
You
yeah.
have no problem.
There's a
And
lot of
yet,
skin in Walk Hard. And a lot of
that's true.
language and it's a pretty confident R.
And yet, I hope I'm not ruining it for anybody to say there's no penis actually in this movie.
Oh, you had to tell everyone.
Well, you know, it's they're all figure Jason Segel's in it. He's just going to whip it out at any moment.
You just assume when you see Jason Segel that eventually you're going to get a shot of his penis.
Jason Segel equals penis. Yeah. Jack Black equals food. Jason equals penis. So you got Cameron, and Cameron was just game and let's go do it. And
she loved it. She felt exactly as I did about the script. And, you know, it's Lee and Jean just wrote something that really, Lee Eisenberg and Jane Stupnitsky wrote it, just sort of like located a joke that for some of us, you know, was irresistible.
And Justin is playing completely against type. We haven't really seen, we've seen this on Saturday Night Live.
We've never seen him not be cool.
Yeah.
For this long, anyway. And it's like, he's hilarious doing it. And, you know, it was really fun doing it with them.
And just also game and let's go and
kind of
try stuff.
Yeah, completely game. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I have to say, like, we ended up with this great group. And, you know, the defining similarity between all of them is that they were all sort of like, this is hilarious, let's go make it, you know.
So was it a hard shoot?
It was hard only in as much as it was short. We did it quickly for a studio movie. We did it in 35 days, which is,
it is quick for studio
on
movie.
The fast side.
Yeah.
And, you know, that has its own challenges and demands, because you got to keep up a pretty rigorous pace.
And the kids, no, isn't
hard
shooting the kids?
That it was hard. What's that?
Isn't it hard shooting the kids with a short schedule?
You mean because they're hours and stuff? Yeah. Or, you know, they're in it just the right amount to where you can work it out pretty easily. Right. You know, when there's kids in every scene, it gets more challenging, but this is not like that. And and you know, the kids are really good and old enough to where it's not like working with children exactly.
Right.
It's like young teenagers, you know, and they were great. It's like a great energy to it, actually, working with them.
And Jason coming along to be the straight man, really?
Yeah, he's kind of the straight man, but he actually just destroys in the movie. So it's like, you know, he's a straight man who gets a laugh almost
That's
every
true.
Time he opens his mouth. But he's straight. He's the straight man.
The smirky straight man until he talks.
What's that?
He's a smirky straight man until he talks.
Yeah, yeah. Well, it's more just that he's the most relatable person of our protagonists, you know. He's sort of the most relatable person in the movie, so it kind of reads as a straight man. But, you know, like I say, I mean, he's as funny as anything or anyone.
So as you get into post on something like this, is it hard to make choices or was it an easy post?
You know, it's always like a process of figuring it out a little bit, but it was a...
The tone is so critical in this.
It was a really pleasant process. It was actually a really fun movie to make, kind of from top to bottom, you know. We were all really well aligned and really trying for the same thing. And so, you know, it was a collaborative and there's a lot of experimenting and trying to figure it out. But you know, a good process.
Is tone hard on something like this? I mean, it seems like you're right walking a line through the whole thing between the likability, dislikability, and the question of how,
yeah,
you know, becoming raunchy for the sake of being raunchy versus just being funny and
That's
dark.
That's right. All of those challenges are real challenges. And that's the figuring it out, you know. But I mean, that's kind of the process on any movie to some extent. And that those particular challenges that you're just talking about, you know, how do we relate to a character that's this that's behaving this badly through this much of the movie? You know, is kind of the central appeal of this movie, and also the challenge in trying to work it out. You know?
Well, you don't often get a character talking about sucking cock within the first, you know, 30 seconds, the first minute and a half of
it's unusual.
Yeah. Just leave from there and get, you know.
That's exactly right.
And then, of course, for us, I saw a screening where the alarm went off in the theater.
I heard about
it. Fun on Friday night. But there was just, and I'm not remembering her name at all, but she's the actress who is also on The Office.
Yeah, Phyllis, yeah. Phyllis
who
Smith.
Gives the, who does, who says titty. And it was like the greatest line reading I've ever heard in my life.
She's sort of, She has that rating, that like shrinking kind of untalking way of talking that is just amazing. It's one of my favorite things in the movie.
So do you just toss all these people into the salad and it kind of comes out with, because you started with the right people? Or how much do you, there has to be some management of it, no?
Sure. There's quite a bit. But the, you know, I'm doing it and working every day, and we do a lot of takes and we work on every part of it, for sure. It's just that the overall effect of what you see,
right,
is largely determined by who's playing the parts and what they're playing, you know. And then you do, the vast majority of your work, I think, ends up being, you know, 10% of what you're perceiving when you watch, right, the movie. It's an important 10%, but it's not, the casting of something like this is just totally definitive.
And your pleasure that you're getting out of it as a director at, uh-huh, this point? I mean, is it, are you, is it about what happens on the set? Is it about the post? Is it about seeing it all come to fruition in the end? Where are you getting your greatest jollies?
I love shooting. I love actually making them. That's my big, that's the fun part for me. You know, I love shooting it, and I love cutting and finishing it, and, you know, the production, the post-production is really fun. Yeah, you kind of can't worry too much about what happens to them. I mean, of course, you do worry a ton. I worry every second, you know, about how it's being received and how it does and all that stuff. But I have found that, like, you never know. Mm. I've had it go okay. I've had it go not so great. And you just can't live or die on that. You have to enjoy the actually making it part, or it's, you know, or that is the good part.
So does it change? I mean, do you feel big shifts in the career when something works better or worse than you're expecting it to? I mean, a picture like this is, you know, I think it's going to be one of the bigger pictures of the summer in terms of the comedies, at least.
Well, I hope you're right. But I have no idea what'll happen ever. Like I said, honestly, it's not just like lip service, but I really do hope so. You know.
But if this is, say, $100 million or $200 million worldwide kind of movie,
that'd be fantastic.
Does that change what you're doing next? Does it change?
I've never had that happen, so I can't. I'll let you know if such a thing were to happen. I would. We'll do a follow up.
Okay. Did you get? Was there ever a time earlier in your career when you got caught up in that whole thing, where you were a little more careerist or thinking about, okay, this will get me to this, and I'm going to try to
No, but I have definitely had my heart broken by people not showing up to movies.
Right.
And that...
audiences, not...
Yeah.
Critics, clearly.
Yeah. I mean, I've gotten bad reviews, but the reviewers have been... you know, on the movies where the audience hasn't showed up, the reviews have generally been pretty good. You just have no idea what's going to happen. You
right. So did you come to the business with that kind of balance?
Well, you come to it with a little less perspective, I think, you know, because you just haven't really thought about that part of it until you've been doing it a little bit, you know.
So your dad didn't impart this on
you?
Oh,
on some
mom?
Level, for sure. I mean, been around all of his movies and seen the many different ways it can go. I think that part of my... you know, I fell in love with the process of it, watching his movies get made. Mm-hmm. So in some ways, I mean, there's a lot of things that I got from him, for sure. A lot. He's my number one teacher. And that kind of appetite to do this work, you know, was partly a product of seeing what it was like on his movies and how much he enjoyed it, and seeing that what an incredibly good gig it is, you know.
And did you were you conscious of, as a young man, of the highs and lows of, you know, his career as things were going? Because there were moments where it was absolutely through the stratosphere, and then there were times where it was harder. And
yeah, I think I was conscious, you know.
So you came in with eyes wide open.
That it could be all different kinds of things, you know, what that roller coaster ride can be, even just on any given movie, you know.
Right. So do you feel like you've had less of a, the highs have been high, less high and the lows less low because of
that perspective? Because I was prepared for it.
Yeah. Or can you prepare for it?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I think it gives you a... I think that maybe I've had the benefit of a perspective that allows me to really remember to be grateful for each one, you know what mm-hmm. I mean? And to know that, like, just because you make it through the door doesn't mean you... You know, you're still dealing with the same basic thing of trying to make good stuff.
Right.
And it's always a challenge to get it going. It's a challenge to do good work. It's hard to write good stuff. It's and then when you do, it's hard to get it made. And it's, you know, it's all just kind of like there are no guarantees. So you just got to really be happy about it every time it mm-hmm. comes together, and you can walk away proud of the movie. You know.
So when did you see this movie with an audience for the first time?
Last summer.
Oh, so it's been a while.
Yeah, well, we finished cutting like right before Christmas. Mm-hmm. It's been done for about 5 months. Yeah.
So what was that like? Was it a happy surprise? Was it pretty much what you expected when you put it up in front of people?
You know, the first time you put up a comedy like this, it's always incredibly nerve-wracking, and mm-hmm. maybe just a function of my personality, but I'm much more focused on, like, what's going to be the nightmare. And there were no nightmares. There was work to do. I mean, mm-hmm. you know, there was plenty of, like, editing and comedy, and you see, like, what they're responding to and what they're responding to less and what mm-hmm. plays the way you hoped and, you know, what is not yet doing what you hoped. And so you see tons of work to do, but there was no massive, like, you know, rejection of anything in particular, mm-hmm. like problems that would be really difficult to solve. You know, there was stuff that I could see that we needed to do.
But you didn't have to restructure an act of the movie.
No, exactly. We didn't have to restructure anything. You know, we ended up shooting a couple more scenes finally, but we didn't have like a, that first screening can be scary, you yeah. know, and it was not a scary result. It was a exciting result that made us want to keep going.
You know? Well, your other pictures, I'd say many of them have been more challenging, I guess, to an audience in uh-huh. terms of that immediate response. Like, you know, it takes, even on something like Walk Hard, it's like, you know, yeah, some people are going to get weird. The joke and some people yeah. aren't going to get the yeah. joke and you're not quite, you know. It lingers in a different way.
Yeah, exactly.
This one is pretty much...
That was my most recent experience, you know, and...
In this case, either you're laughing or you're not, either you're, you know, leaving yeah. and going to Fox News and complaining.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
There are only two that's options,
right.
really.
That's right, yeah. That's right. I mean, that turns out to be the case. You don't quite know that day of that first preview.
But, right. So did yeah. it come together, did it fix up easily, or was it... Does it become more difficult when you're dealing with little things instead of actually having a big, any kind of problem that you have to like focus on?
Does it become easier, did you say?
Well, is it more challenging in a way to fix little things than it is to fix a big thing that is a project, or?
It's more, you know, when you feel like you have massive work to do, it's really right. stressful. And mm-hmm. When you feel like you're basically, you know, doing comedy and story kind of work based mm-hmm. on footage that you basically do have, mm-hmm. It's just, you know, that's the job. And it's not rot in the same right. way that it is when you feel like you have to, like, rebuild it, you know, mm-hmm. on an architectural level.
Hard to sit on
this
it
for... This was never like that, you know.
Hard to sit on it for 6 months after you're done?
It was actually kind of great, I have to say, huh. because we're excited about it. We were excited that the studio was excited, you know. And the thing that can be a little bit brutal when you talk about like the roller coaster ride is the thing where you're like mixing the movie and then the next week you're talking about it and getting reviews and then it's out and like it's been less than a month from the time you you know, finished it to the mm-hmm. time it's kind of over. That can be a really exhausting and rough, you know, there's something great about separating out the experience of making it mm-hmm. from the experience of releasing it. So it's actually been really nice, you know.
So you didn't have any doubts in middle May or middle of, you know, April, all of a sudden, like, oh, maybe I have to go back and fix it, or?
No, I just like started completely working on other things and thinking about other things, and you know, I didn't allow myself to do that, really.
And do you just move on? Is that your, as a director, is that your mindset? Are you, when you're done, are you done?
Well, that's what you try to do, you know. I mean, it's a part of you, and you feel powerfully protective of it and all of that, you mm-hmm. know. But when you're done working on it, it's no longer occupying the same
right.
brain space, you know.
So what will you do on opening night?
I'll probably go see it. Yeah. No, I mean, I like to try to go on, you know, when it, that first night.
You stand in the back of the room, or you yeah. blend in?
I can't actually watch the whole movie at this point, you know, but I'll watch big chunks of it in a mm-hmm. couple of theaters, and, you know, you hope people are laughing. And that's the thing about these kind of comedies is, like, you spend a lot of time, anxiously hoping people laugh, and then when you get it to where you know that they do to some extent, you know, mm-hmm. then it's like fun to hear it, you know.
So is there like a little joke that maybe they get, maybe they don't get, that's early on in the picture that you are waiting for? Because you get big yeah. laughs right away. We often have the conversation about, you know, are you waiting for a moment in the film where you know you have the audience, and this one you're gonna hear the big laughter pretty quickly.
Yeah, well, you can tell based on how the first 5 minutes or so play, just kind of how hot the room is. And
mm-hmm. and are you going to be waiting for, you know, Friday afternoon matinee numbers from the East Coast to worry about, or do you think about that a whole lot at this point?
You know, I'm sure that day I'll be thinking about it. I'll be shooting something actually that day, which hopefully will take a little bit of the you know, hand-wringing energy out of it.
And make sure your assistant has your BlackBerry. So
yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Get the notes from Sony. About
yeah, that's right.
Exactly what's going on.
That's exactly right.
And do you get involved at this point with the marketing and all this stuff? I mean, obviously you're putting yourself out there, but do you?
I am involved, but they have great people who do it here. And I've been less involved in the sort of, you know, I talk to them a lot. They show us everything, but right. They're very talented, the people who are working on this movie. So.
So something must have sucked about this experience. It sounds like this was like a kind
no,
of
this was, this,
perfect
I
experience.
I mean, not yet. There's 100 ways it could,
it could still go
up,
bad.
Screw up from here on. But the actual experience of it, nothing sucked, I gotta say. It was like really fun movie to make, you know. And we all like each other. It's like a boring story.
When that happens, it's actually really nice.
Yeah, it's great.
Good change of pace.
No complaints. Yeah, exactly.